So my name is Bojan Bozinovski, and I've been writing code for a long time, mostly C# and JavaScript. I'd like to ask you some questions, like how many of you had a chance to write a desktop application? What about how many of you are JavaScript developers? Most of you can write this application with JavaScript now with Electron. So the agenda of this presentation will talk about some history in native UI, and then what is Electron, why desktop applications, and why is this important. So we used to write application in the past in the native way, and we had to write different code for every different platform. So on Windows, we wrote MSC and C++. On macOS, if we want to write native applications, we had to write with Objective-C. Then later came Qt as a cross-platform C++ framework from Linux that we can write applications with Qt for Windows and Mac, but it was not easy to write applications with C++. Most of the applications, or the line of business applications that businesses use, were written in managed languages like .NET and Java. So banks and a lot of business applications. We wrote applications in Beamforms and VBF for them, and some of the developers wrote Java applications using the Swing framework or the Eclipse SVT framework. But the independent software vendors the other ones have written desktop application mostly native UI with the MSC and macOS for the end users for a better experience and faster applications. This way the development was slower, and we always had two code bases for the applications. So this is where Electron comes in, and Electron motto is that if you are a JavaScript developer and if you can build a website, you can build a desktop application also. So some pros about Electron. We use familiar technologies that you as a web developer know to write the desktop application. We use HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and Electron is composed of Node.js and Chromium, so we can use both front-end and back-end JavaScript technologies. There are also a lot of ready and solved problems in the Electron world, so for you to build the application as a whole and as one package and to not have any additional dependencies. So the end user will not have to install Node.js or Chrome on his machine, but the application will be shipped as a whole package, so it's an easier deployment. So some of the cons, some say that it's a cons to that HTML and CSS are used for application. And if your company doesn't have web developers, there are also native developers. Electron is mostly targeted at JavaScript and web developers as a way to write desktop applications. Also, some drawback, like any website with JavaScript and modern frameworks, some of the applications can use a lot of memory or CPU. That is true mostly for any Chrome and V8 page that is doing optimizations for the JavaScript engine. So some history. GitHub was created initially for the Atom editor. Electron was created at GitHub for the Atom editor, but it was not named Electron. It was named Atom Shell, and there was some confusion for what it can be used. And a year later, GitHub decided to rename Atom Shell to Electron, so everyone can know that this platform can be used for writing different applications, not only for their code editor. So they started in January 2013. Now the stable version is 5.0, and the first the 0.1 release was in May 2016. So Electron allows you rapid development, the JavaScript development that we all know, with the hot reload and faster development. In the native world, you had to wait between compile times for 10, 12, 20 minutes before you see the UI change that you made. And now we only got like a second or two between the reloads to see the change that we made, make it the HTML or the JSFX code. Also, the deployment, as I said, is a solved problem, and there are ready packages and servers for doing silent targets. If you've used Visual Studio Code, you're used to the background updating when you receive a notification about that there is a new update and will be downloaded in the background. The update is ready, and one click away, you got the new version changed on the client side. So you always have the desktop application to the newer version, like the evergreen browser, like Chrome always updates itself. Also, Electron gives us some of the native user experience that native applications have. So we can have native windows and native menus across Mac, Linux, Windows, and tray balloons, notifications, integration with the printing dialogues in the native style, not a web style, and other native capabilities of the operating system. So it integrates with easily with the stores, with the Apple store, with the Windows store, and other stores. Also, we can share a lot of JavaScript HTML code for the UI if you already have like a web application, and you can share a lot of code with your desktop application. And one thing that companies like is teaming and customizing your applications. That can be done very easy with Electron because everything is CSS here. So you can choose whatever UI framework, front-end framework you want, because this is standard Chrome engine, and you can use React, Vue, Angular, or whatever JavaScript framework you want for the front-end part. So why desktop applications? Sometimes you need something more than a web application. You want to have an offline capabilities for your application to work when you do not have internet. You want access to printers and advanced printing scenarios. You want access to some USB devices or some scanners or some other point of sale devices. You want to deploy on premises inside companies. You want to deploy internally in some company where line of business application where the company has strict security rules and does not want to expose any of its services outside of their domain. You want access to local files outside of the web sandbox. You want to edit documents, inside dialogs, inside user folders. Electron applications can be easily published on the stores, so you can monetize them, like in the Apple Store, Mac Store, or the Windows Store. sometimes in some companies you can more easily publish a desktop application inside the internet than a web application inside the company. And for some categories of applications, it just feels right to have a desktop application. So these are some kinds of application, desktop applications that most of us would prefer to use a desktop application instead of a website. So yeah, most of us, for example, use an application for the messaging or for the email client or for the editors that we call it. So the original application that Electron was written for, it's the Atom editor. It's a very nice editor. Also, I think you know this application, most of you. I can say that this is the highest, most popular Electron application, and it's very representative of good optimizations done on an Electron application because it's faster than the most of the Electron applications. So, Electron, for some years, like from 2010, most of the developers switched to write web applications and mobile applications. But we now see some renaissance of the desktop applications because Electron gave us, the web developers, an easier way to write desktop applications. So Skype is written in Electron and uses React. GitHub, the previous version was written in C# for Windows, but now it also is React and Electron. What else every one of you knows? Slack? Yeah. So, a lot of applications. So, about the architecture of the Electron application. So, here, Electron starts from one process that is called the main process, but this main process does not contain the UI. If we start only this process, it's the coordinating process where the main application starts. So, if we want to show the first window, do not have a command line application. We use something called a browser window that is started from the main process, and Electron calls these processes renderer processes. These renderer processes are Chrome embedded inside the browser window. So Electron uses Node.js and Chrome. But most of you will think that this is some kind of a server client architecture, but we can open whatever number of rendering view processes we like. And Node.js can be used on the main process and even integrated inside the rendering process. So we get to use the benefits of both of the backend Node.js APIs and any frontend library. So the main process starts, and when we open the first instance of one window, browser window, the shell of the window, it is also hosted in the main process. Inside of it, the rendering is done with Chrome, and that's the render process that gets embedded inside the browser window. And there is a way to communicate between these processes. So there is an inter-process communication APIs in Electron. So this will be some minimal example of a demo. It's very easy to start with Electron. Just npm install Electron, and you need package.json file and npm init, a main.js file that will represent the main process, and at least one HTML file for the rendering process. So, because this is the Node.js world, we import Electron dependencies as Electron modules with require. So, we load instance and API from Electron. Browser window is a constructor class that used to open any number of windows that we like. But here we will open one window, main window. So in the app, there are many events from the life cycle of the application. So the main one is the ready event. And when Electron is ready, we can create an instance of the browser window that, as I said, is still inside the main process. But the content, the HTML that will load inside the browser window, it will be a separate process. So browser window has many options. We had a lot of options to configure the look and the behavior of the native window. There are methods to load an HTML file or URL here. We can even load online content. So if we do not have any JavaScript code, and the rendering process will open this index.html, it will render hello world. The title goes to the native title of the browser window, and the content is rendered inside the Chrome here. So this part here is part of the main process, and everything down is the rendering process. That's in terms of JavaScript frontend, the rendering process is the main UI thread, but we have a separate process as the main application thread. So Electron has a Node.js integration even on the frontend side, even on the rendering process. So we can have access to the process global variable where we can see the versions of the both Electron and Chrome rendering engine. So if you look this example on the front end, you can do some stuff that are desktop-like, that are outside of the web sandbox. So even if though that we are on the front end, we can require some Node.js module for the file system and read here the example reads the names of the folders inside the home folder of the user. So in a classical web application, we do not have access outside of the sandbox and reading files and folders, but this is the main reason we write desktop applications. So we can have access and already use standard APIs that are known to you, like the developers that wrote Node.js. To debug the rendering process, to show the standard Chrome development tools in debugger, they can be shown from the standard menu, or if we override the menu, we can attach, we can open them with code, like we can open the debugger with JavaScript from here. And there are different. There is a different way to debug the main process, because that is a standard Node.js process. It's not a UI process like Chrome. I will talk about some inbuilt modules inside Electron. Inside the main process, some of these modules are. Can be used in the main process, some of them can be used on the rendering processes, or some of them can be used on both. The main module is the app module, where you get the lifecycle events and everything about the instance as well. This is a very important module, inter-process communication. It's like a pub-sub API, publish-subscribe. It allows us to communicate with between the rendering process and the main process. There are two modules like that. There is one for the main client, the IPC main, and IPC renderer for the IPC renderer, and we can send messages with some arguments from the rendering process to the main process, and also from the main process to the rendering process. This can be done in synchronous and async way, but most of them are used in async way because the synchronous one block all of the communication between the processes, and you can easily get to a deadlock situation. The dialogue module, it allows us to open native safe as dialogue, native open dialogue, native printing dialogue, native messages, and so on. We can also open them as model dialogues. Also, the menu API and menu item, we can build a native menus that look like the standard native menus on Windows, and on Mac they are on the top native menu, so they are totally native. One other module is the power monitor, where we can, if we are on a, let's say on a laptop machine, we can detect when the system has low battery or goes to sleep or goes to suspend, or we can detect when the user removes the power adapter from the laptop, or are we on the battery or are we on power. There is also a module for the tray, so we can show native notifications on Windows or macOS. I said about inside the rendering module, we can use communication with IPC renderer to the main module. There is also one specialized kind of remote calling of the main module. So for to be easier for us, there is a remote module that you can call remotely methods on the main process from the rendering process, and you can embed with this web frame. You can embed browsers, like a whole browser with the sandbox inside your HTML. So it will not be an iframe, it will be a full Chrome inside some tag of your HTML. So there are also other important modules that are available to both of this, the main and the rendering process. You have access to the clipboard, you can make your app crash resilient and send crash reports to a server, or catch crashes and reload the application immediately. This native image is used for showing previews on the taskbar, or showing images inside native notifications. Your application can have multi-monitor support with the screen module. You know the resolution of the monitors, their position, their geometry. Detect changes on removing an HDMI cable or removing second monitor. And the shell, you can open, let's say you have a button, you want to open some URL, you can call the natively set by the user browser, and you can open Chrome from a native Electron application or whatever file type you want. Like if you want to open an image with the default image viewer on the browser, or call some native protocol, you can use it with the shell module. So deploying Electron applications, it's also very easy. You just install some Electron package node module, and you can package the Electron runtime that consists both of the Node.js and Chrome and application host exe inside one folder, and you can make the application like one zip file portable application or an app application for macOS Or for Linux, you can create packages like Debian. And also, you can create setups like MSI setups or wizards or native macOS setups for your application to install for every user on the machine, not per user. And there is a module for auto-updating of the application. There are also servers for supporting the updating of the applications. Also, if you do not have a server, you can host the updates on GitHub. It's some easier way to host updates for your application. For debugging this communication between the processes, there is a Electron dev tool for listening to communication, IPC communication between the processes. And you can use the standard debug tools for debugging the rendering process. So there are also boilerplate projects, like there is not official CLI, but there are community projects. They're highly popular, like Electron Forge, that gives you templates, so you can have starting templates for starting to work on an Electron application, and they have templates for React, for Angular, for Vue.js, and there is one large React boilerplate also that contains many stuff inside of it. There is a Vue one, and to bootstrap and to start learn, there is a really good quick start for minimal Electron application, and there is a demo application official from Electron with demos of the most used APIs. So, some tips: the desktop users don't want to show like on link. They want to see a default cursor to feel that like they are in a desktop application, like not in a website. And some Electron developers. You can listen to an event on if you have multiple windows, and on close, instead of closing them, you can hide them, and when they need to open again, they will open faster if you show them. But this is a pro con because the window stays in the background and it's memory. And if you want to write some like server client scenarios or some background tasks or jobs, it's better to create some hidden background window and communicate with it through the main and offload background, some intensive background work there. The main process is better to be left not to have a job almost all of the time, so it's not recommended to have background intensive work on the main process to have a responsive desktop application. So there's a great list with awesome Electron packages, yeah, and the documentation on the Electron website is very good. Because I have time, I will try to show you a demo. So this is the Electron API demos application that I talked about. Here you have examples for the most used APIs, how to create a new window, what code goes inside the rendering process, how to handle crashes, how to catch the crash event and reload the application. how to create a native menu like this up here, or the macOS native menu. So it's just a simple JSON structure with the shortcuts that are supported also on Mac, CMD or control, and capture events on the menus. Global shortcuts, like I said about the shell, if on some click on some button you want to show some item in that folder, it's very easy how to show a native notification, just a new notification. System dialogs, like let's say a save dialog. Just dialog, show save dialog with some options, which extensions to show the program. This is the main communication between the processes. The IPC renderer is inside the main view, inside the renderer. And if we want to send a message to the main process, just as a string, we send the command name, the event name, and some values. This can be any JSON object here. And also the rendering process can hear any other message like pass subscribe. The main process will hear this message and react to it, and he can call back and return the result to the rendering process. Minimal Electron application. So you npm init and install a dependency on Electron. And the main JS is the main process where the Electron application starts. On npm start, you are just starting Electron, and that was the main JS file. Electron as a dependency. Let's see. It's somewhere over here. So this is the host Electron that will start your application. This gets packaged with the Electron packages and with all of the dependencies as a desktop app. But during development, so let's see a main JS file. So as I said, we require Electron, and here we are waiting for the ready event. Create window. This creates the main browser window plus the HTML file for the render. We can in the newer versions, the node integration is set the default to false for security reasons, and we can enable node integration. But if we are loading some online script, it will be better to be loaded in some other web view tag for security reasons, where Node.js is not integrated. So this is the ready event. You can have multiple windows and wait for all of them to close before quitting the application. It's native on macOS to not quit the application even after all of the windows are closed. It stays in the tray and user manually quits it. And if we see an HTML file, standard HTML file. And here we are using the file system APIs from Node.js to open up native open dialog. And show a text file, read the text, and change the text and save it with a save. Let's try to start this. So if we open up some file from a file system, hello DevCon, and change 2019, we have access to the file system or the desktop to save the file. Here is okay. So yeah, that was it. Any questions?
What about the state management passing data between forms? What can be used?
You can. If you render the whole frontend on one browser window, you can, let's say, React, and you can use the React state management like Redux, and you can show material UI dialogs that are not native dialogs, but and that is only on one process. You do not have to open multiple processes. And the main process is always a singleton, and you can, let's say, store data there in that, but it's not recommended. Or you can save to any database, because you have access to all of the Node APIs. Let's say you can catch SQLite or some embedded database inside the app data folder and store data for your application there.
Many of us don't like, I personally like Chrome, but it is becoming a problem when it starts about 20-30 processes in the background. Because it uses Chromium as backbone for the application, I want to know how many processes does this take, and what toll does it have on a system?
Yeah, the Electron application usually use a lot of memory, but it does not have to be that way. It does not depend only on the number of processes. It's how good your application is written. Let's see an example here. So Visual Studio Code. Inside Visual Studio Code, here you have a Process Explorer. Usually one Electron application starts with at least two processes, the main process and the one rendering process. If you open the debugger, that's the third process. Here, in this open simple project, Visual Studio Code has, what, like 15 processes, like the main process, the first window that opened, some background watch, the terminal that I opened inside some view inside Visual Studio Code, some integration with Node.js, and the rig that I started from the command line, the crash reporters, Visual Studio Code also sandboxes extensions on some other process to not crash the main Visual Studio Code. But Visual Studio Code is a great example how an Electron application can be fast and not use too much memory and be performant. So it depends on the developer.
So if we make a simple application and don't need many processes, we can actually have a few processes in the background.
Most of the applications have, let's say, 2-3 processes, but it's not only that. You can have one rendering process and do a lot of front-end stuff not optimized inside that process. And it will eat like a gig of memory if you have a not optimized front-end code inside that rendering process.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
So ever since people started using the internet, not just for browsing, but for also building apps, there has been a constant catch-up of web apps trying to catch up with what the native apps offer. And I think probably in two aspects, it's performance and the user interface, where web apps would typically fail catching up. They have other pros again, of course. So do you think Electron is the one that actually can match native performance and user interface?
So yeah, you were right. With Electron, we are exposed to all of the native capabilities of other native IPS that in a web app we do not have. But performance-wise, maybe it will always be faster if you know how to optimize a native app. But it requires a lot of effort and money to have a native application. There are other solutions, but not as mature as Electron. That, like React Native for Windows, that's not cross-platform, where you can use JavaScript, but also have a fully native UI, not an HTML UI. And there will be a brighter future, even after Electron.
What would you your option be between progressive web apps and Electron app?
Okay, so this is a similar question like the previous one. So if anything, we can thank Electron for popularizing desktop applications written with JavaScript technologies. So it showed there is a need for JavaScript developers to create desktop applications. So that's where progressive web app comes. And progressive web app is useful for some of the scenarios where Electron is used. And you can have a desktop icon, you can have offline capabilities. But if you want even more outside of the web sandbox capabilities, outside to have access to a larger file system or a larger storage, then you have to exit the sandbox and the PWA. So PWAs are great, but they don't solve most of the scenarios that the Electron was, but they solve enough scenarios where you will be better writing a progressive web app instead of Electron, because you have easier discoverability with progressive web app. It's just a website where you have a manifest, you can install it offline on the desktop. You do not have to download an application.
Anyone else? Thank you, Bojan.